Good afternoon. Again, it's nice to be with you. Thank you for joining us on this Tuesday, where I'll just give you a brief update on some of the basic core numbers for COVID-19 in California. And then I want to spend a little time talking about flu and COVID and a bit of what we're seeing in young people and kids. As a pediatrician, something near and dear to my heart, and I know many of you who work with kids or have your own or are grandparents, wondering what the impact of COVID has been broadly on children across our state. So to start, today reporting 4,636 new cases in California. I want to remind you that that represents really cases reported on Sunday into early morning Monday. And Sunday is typically our lowest reporting day for a lot of reasons related to the weekend. So we're not surprised to see what is a lower number. We work with the team to make sure that all of our data systems are working appropriately and feel confident that they are. So we look forward to making sure that all the numbers continue to be complete and accurate and timely, and we feel that way about this new case number. Also reporting, sadly, that we have 100 new deaths in California related to COVID, as well as after seeing roughly two weeks of day-over-day decreases in our hospital numbers, we saw a small increase in hospitalizations related to COVID, 86 new individuals hospitalized overall, or the number's 86 higher than it had been reported yesterday, which, as the governor reminds us, one day is not a trend, but it's an important number that we'll continue to watch to ensure that it doesn't become a trend, reaching out to some of our hospital partners to try to understand what might have led to the increase, if it's a real increase. So we'll keep everyone posted on that very important number. Now I want to spend a few minutes talking through a few slides with you. As I said, flu season, is right around the corner, and we must be prepared. We've been planning for flu in a much more aggressive way this season because of COVID-19 and the risk of having, on the one hand, a COVID-19 pandemic and a number of cases and transmission, and in a very similar transmission pattern, flu coming in the late fall and parts of winter, which we typically deal with in California. We know that it has the ability to stress our hospital systems on its own, but this year, together, flu and COVID make us particularly worried and have caused us to jumpstart some of that flu plan. Outbreaks of flu and COVID together will certainly cause a drain on already scarce healthcare resources. We've been talking to you for many months about preparing our surge capacity in hospitals and even in our clinic settings, and that will become even more vital as we prepare for admissions increase, not just around COVID, but around flu as well. So just like wearing a mask is important for COVID, it is also protective in flu. But unlike COVID, with flu, we actually have a vaccine, and it's a great way to keep ourselves safe and keep ourselves healthy during the pandemic and flu season. And so this year, getting your flu vaccine is especially important because it will also not just protect you and your communities, but it may be exactly what allows you to avoid an unnecessary visit to an emergency room in an urgent care if you can keep your likelihood of having upper respiratory tract type of symptoms and in fact of an upper respiratory tract infection to a minimum. And we know that additional movement into emergency rooms and urgent care centers might actually create an exposure risk to COVID-19. As I mentioned, just quickly, I want to talk to you a little bit about what has been the impact of COVID-19 on children. We have, as a state, reported just about 62,200 cases of COVID-19 in young people 0 to 17. This represents about 10% of our state's cases. Just as by way of comparison, about 22% of Californians are aged 0 to 17. So relative to the number of young people in our population, we have a much lower percentage of the cases of COVID-19 in the state. That said, about 570 young people 0 to 17 have been admitted to hospitals with COVID, and about 60 of those have been admitted to an ICU. I'll tell you, in a recent publication nationally that looked at about 570 young people who were hospitalized with COVID-19, about a third of those across the nation were admitted to the ICU. So we have a much lower ICU admission rate for young people in California compared to at least this one national study that was just released. Additionally, it's noteworthy that just like we've talked about the disproportionate impact on Latinos altogether across all age groups, the same disparity holds with 71.5% of our cases 0 to 17 impacting Latino children across the state. This slide here looks at one of the other, what I will just say, troubling challenges of COVID-19's impact on young people and frankly adults as well. But this slide shows that one of the key vaccines that kindergarten age children receive on their way into school, the MMR, the measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine. Looking at this year, you can see the gray shaded area is what we've seen in 2019. You see a steady flow of young children, 4 to 6, getting that second MMR vaccination. Throughout the year, you see a peak in August, which represents kids returning back to school, and then sort of this downward trend around the holidays. In 2020, we saw the beginning of the year start out just like 2019, but when we went to a stay-at-home order and many of our healthcare facilities went to more tele or virtual visits, fewer in-person visits, we saw what we expected, which was a significant decrease in vaccinations for young people. And we now hope to have a period of increased levels of vaccinations as more pediatric and family practice clinics open up their services and they control the movement into the clinic, but they have available appointments. We hope to see that number increase. The fact that we are still fairly low relative to the peak in August gives us concern and allows me to encourage families and caregivers, parents who can schedule, use this time to schedule that critical appointment to catch up on some vaccinations, that this is a perfect time to do that so that we don't lose some of the important gains that California has made in really keeping a high number of our children vaccinated for many of the important infectious diseases that we want to protect our families, children, and communities from. This looks a little bit beyond MMR, the measles, mumps, and rubella, and looks at vaccines altogether for children 0 to 18. You can see that over the course of 2020 compared to 2019, that we're running at about 2/3 our vaccination level for all groups, races, and ethnicity across the state. And that this is a pattern that we hope to use the next many weeks, the next 8 to 10 weeks, really before we start to see flu season become a more credible risk, to catch up on this number. I know that many of you may feel a little uneasy about going to the doctor's office these days. I think that healthcare providers have shared with me, and I've seen it firsthand, the wonderful protective measures that they put in place to keep families and patients safe while they're in waiting rooms and going into their physicians' offices. I think many visits that can still happen through telehealth or virtual visits are occurring that way. But if there is a critical need for you to come in person for any reason, including to receive vaccinations, we know that health providers across the state have taken extraordinary measures, like many sectors, to protect their patients and ensure that there's no increased risk to COVID-19 or other communicable diseases at this critical time. And we know that this is important because as we consider returning back to school, that certain social distancing measures ease a bit, that we want to make sure that kids are protected against common childhood illnesses, vaccine preventable illnesses like measles, like whooping cough, to ensure that not only they, our kids, our own kids are protected, but that they don't inadvertently expose a vulnerable child at a school or another setting to an avoidable vaccine preventable illness. And likewise among adults, we know that this is an opportunity where if you missed a critical adult vaccine to prevent a disease like shingles or pneumonia, that this is similarly a good time. I also just want to say that with flu, we know that this is the period, and just right now, many big health systems, many clinics are starting to receive their flu vaccine shipments, that it's worth a call now to your provider to see if it's available and how you can best receive the flu vaccine so that you can check that off your list, get it done now, so you avoid any rush in the next many weeks and you are protected against one of our two big worries as we enter the fall and winter with flu and COVID together. And as we always do, I just want to take a moment before we get into a series of questions to remind us that it's these simple acts that can make a big difference, not just for COVID-19, but flu also. Wearing your mask, maintaining that 6 feet of physical distance, washing your hands, and minimizing mixing. And I'll add also, both for flu and COVID, that if you're having any sort of symptoms like that are consistent with COVID or flu, that we recommend that you stay home, seek medical attention if you need it, but really try to avoid mixing, especially when you have symptoms like fevers, cough, runny nose, etc. So with that, I just want to again thank you all for joining me, and I'll turn to questions.
Bill Willing, the Los Angeles Times.
Hi, Doctor. How
are
you doing?
Great, Bill. How are you?
Just want to find out if the backlog in the data has been cleared and the counties have all the data that they were waiting for, number one. And number two is, when a county falls off the watch list, what does that mean practically? Does that mean kids can start going back to the classroom? Does that mean businesses can open more for, like, in-person dining or anything like that? What's the practicality of it?
Yeah, Phil, thanks for both questions. So as I mentioned, even as we looked at today's number, we're doing constant quality checks at both our rate and ability to get the data, the information on labs and cases through our CalReady system. And we have no current backlog and very few, no unusual number of cases waiting to be processed. So at the state level, we have identified those cases that I talked about, roughly 10 days ago, that 295 or 250 to 300, 250,000 to 300,000 records. We've worked through all of those. We've sent the positive cases to the counties, who then need to add some additional information like race, ethnicity, whether it's a person who works in a healthcare setting, et cetera, as much of that information that we can have, so we enrich our data at the state level, and then we report it as a case. So we feel fairly confident that we have seen the majority of those cases show up in our numbers. The governor shared a definitive number yesterday, and we feel today that that is the right number. We continue, as we have throughout this entire response, to work with our counties to ensure that they have all the data that they need, or that they're expecting, that we have good comparisons, and they don't have more than we do, and we don't have more than they do, to ensure that all the systems are running as they should. And as always, there are some questions here and there, and we track them down with our county partners to make sure we fulfill those needs. And right now, there are some questions open with a couple of counties that we continue to work through, but not necessarily more than we normally have. So we feel confident that the worry that we had 2+ weeks ago with the data, that we worked through those systems, and that our CalReady system is working as it should. But I'll remind you, as the governor has pushed me and us as a team to identify a replacement system that will allow us to more confidently, without as many IT issues potentially occurring, create a new COVID data repository that the state is working hard and quickly to put in place. With regards to what it means to come off the data monitoring list, we said in our July 13th order, public health officer order, that counties that were on the list had to implement some sector closures and modifications, and that as counties came off the list, we would consider what that update to the state health officer order would be that would then allow certain sectors to begin to move from where they are today to potentially a degree of being reopened, whether that's more outdoors or some beginning indoors. We are working through that internally, looking at the data closely, ensuring that the timing is right with our case levels across the state and specific counties, working with those county leaders, both in public health and local electeds, to ensure that we put together a system that is simple and allows us to move forward with confidence. The one caveat on that, Phil, is that we do have the K-6 school, elementary school waiver option for counties that are on the data monitoring list below 200 cases per 100,000 over the last 14 days to potentially, in a very prescribed process, apply for an elementary school waiver to allow in-person on-campus instruction for those younger students, that many of whom have already started school in a virtual distance learning manner.
Bobby Efficient, ANX Radio.
Thanks for taking the question. I'm sorry if you talked about this earlier and I missed it, but can I get a breakdown of that backlog? How many were actually COVID test results, how many positive and negative? And if you happen to know, how many might be from LA County? And then also, I'm wondering how quickly the replacement system can get up and running. Thank you.
Yeah, so I went through some of that. I don't have all of that information handy right at my fingertips, but we will work to get you the data I don't have at the moment. We had roughly 295,000 backlogged messages. Not every one of those messages, and I'm key on using the word messages because they don't all represent a case, either positive or negative. Many are duplicates. So after deduplicating those 295,000 records, we send all of the unique records into another system, of which about 14,000, I believe it was 800, were positive test results. Those have all gone to the counties to do the process that I mentioned earlier, where they enrich each case with additional demographic and other information that helps us understand the impact on different groups across the state. We can get to you the exact number of negative tests from that 295,000 backlog messages, And we feel confident, as I said, and I'll reiterate, that we have worked through that backlog successfully. The specific number for Los Angeles County, I don't want to give you the wrong number, so we'll get back to you that, on that as well. I will tell you our process, which is multi-step to make, to have the replacement system available, is going well. I want to thank our partners at the California Department of Technology and Amy Tong in particular, my team at Health and Human Services working with the California Department of Public Health IT leadership to really aggressively but thoughtfully choose a system that can function and manage the level of records that we're seeing with COVID-19. And without putting an exact deadline, I'm very pleased with the progress and think we're weeks away, not months away, from that replacement system.
Andrew Sheeler, the Sacramento Bee.
Hi, Doctor. Thank you for your time. Gavin Newsom has said that hospitalizations are going down, but the state is adding even more counties to the watch list. Are we starting to go in the wrong direction again?
So what we have seen in the counties that have been added over, you know, really yesterday as a result of working through some of those backlog numbers and reassessing the day over day changes, those largely were smaller counties, more rural northern counties, and we absolutely have seen a greater reduction in cases and hospitalizations in the southern part of the state versus the northern part of the state. So the fact that a few smaller counties have been added to the county data monitoring list should not be either surprising or an issue of major concern. When you look at the overall statewide trends, which we do see coming down both in cases and in hospitalizations. So we don't feel like we're moving in the wrong direction. We also think that the county data monitoring list, which gives us an opportunity to work more closely with each county to ensure all of the different tools that we have at our disposal, like testing, disease investigation, and contact tracing, are indeed robust enough to manage what is the reality of some places seeing even slight increases in cases. So we don't feel like that's at all a mixed message. We see that overall the state picture is stabilizing and coming down some. But as we've always said, this is not about the aggregate. It is about what's experienced at the county level, at the regional level, and continuing to look at some regions that are having increases and making sure we use our data monitoring program to assist counties and support counties in a successful response.
Adam Beam, AP.
Hi. Yesterday, the administration announced that Santa Cruz came off the monitoring list, and it looks like San Diego has come off too. What did those counties do well, and what would you advise that other counties adopt? And as you're modifying the reopening guidelines, how confident are you that the infection rate levels you've established won't lead to another spike?
So thank you for the question. I think, look, many counties across the state are doing things really well. And we see a lot of increased use of masking in some counties. We see just isolate when they're sick. That really helps cut down transmission. Others are able to identify some of our congregate settings and outbreaks there and keeping those tamped down into a minimum. So I would say that all our counties are doing certain things well. Santa Cruz, San Diego, some others that are nearing, coming off the county data monitoring list. They have likely been at some of these efforts potentially a little longer. They have been able to work with skilled nursing facilities, other jails and prisons and other congregate facilities, their essential workplaces in the agricultural and the textile and the poultry and meat packing areas in different ways. So all of those strategies are additive and together come and help a specific county improve its trajectory. And as we hope will be the result, not just in Santa Cruz and San Diego and others, that all counties improve transmission, that we see and enjoy what we've seen over the last many days is some reductions and certainly stabilizations in these numbers, that we see that statewide. So those are the tools. I mean, in many ways, the things that we've all been talking about are exactly the ways that we reduce transmission and not just have individuals experience less risk, but counties as a whole have a lower rate of transmission happening as a result coming off the county data monitoring list. In terms of our look at refining our approach to data monitoring, we've learned a great deal across our response. We understand how hospitalizations as a number impact and tell us what we're experiencing, just like we understand testing and case numbers. So our purpose of ensuring that we modify the approach so that it is more targeted, more specific, and allows us to stay in front more, I think gives us a degree of confidence that we will do better in anticipating potential increases in transmission and intervene to ensure that those higher rates of transmission don't go up so high that it puts a material risk to our healthcare system's capacity to serve people when they're sick and at all create additional concern for people who move about their communities in a modified normal way that we anticipate we'll be doing for many, many months to come.
Angela Hart, Kaiser Health News.
Thank you, Secretary Ghaly. I want to ask you about a testing update, but first I just wanted to ask you about this. I'm just now reading about the first case of plague in 5 years in South Lake Tahoe. So I wanted to see if there's any additional information you can provide about that issue and whether you're concerned about that, yet another concern about that. And then if you don't mind for the testing question, I just wonder if you could provide us an update on whether the state's testing efforts are working sufficiently and reaching enough people.
Yeah, so on the plague question, I'll just say, I've been notified our CDPH team is digging in and understanding how big a risk that is. I mean, anytime you have a human case, which we haven't had in a number of years, our vigilance goes up, not even because it's COVID and our discussion about flu, but any infectious disease that you aren't seeing and then you begin to see raises your risk tolerance or at least your focus on mitigating the risk of spread. So we are absolutely doing that. And as concerns come up, happy to share that information as we do on our websites and through notifications about any concern. And as I say often, as we get worried, I say to my patients, I'll tell you when I'm worried so you can worry with me. We'll do the same as we have with many of these other issues along the way. As it goes with COVID-19 testing, we are starting to see the fruits of some of our labors. And I think that it's both what we've done in the state, but also what's happening nationally. If you look a month ago, we had a swell of cases in many big states that really put a pressure on the national testing supplies. Big corporations like LabCorp and Quest were seeing more tests than they'd ever seen because a number of states that weren't testing at the volume that California has typically tested at were starting to test more, and you were beginning to see backlogs. Those backlogs have improved because fewer tests probably being done. Those bigger lab corporations have increased their own capacity to handle more tests. So I've heard that directly from our LabCorp and Quest partners, as well as in California, efforts to align where tests are being collected to labs that are able to process them more quickly. We've done that not just in community testing sites that the state runs, but also for some of the prisons, certain skilled nursing facilities. So doing that sort of supply-demand matching has been effective and paid off. In terms of ensuring that we get testing to the right people, I'm really proud of our collective resolve, really led by our task force chairs, who are very focused on ensuring disproportionately impacted communities are getting testing they need. The state, under their guidance and leadership, is near finalizing a competitive RFP, request for proposals, to increase our ability to do more mobile testing in certain more rural communities where we might be able to pull up testing right to the front door of a factory or a farm, so that individuals who, one reason or another, don't feel like getting tested at a more formal site or a clinic can get tested there. That not only gives us a chance to do more testing, but it gives us a chance to provide more information and education and to give guidance to people who might have symptoms to in fact go and isolate while or quarantine while we wait for those results. So all of these things are efforts that I think are improving testing turnaround time, improving the likelihood that a test result is useful, meaning that it gives people more current information, allows county health departments to do disease investigation and effective contact tracing, and will ultimately help us in achieving greater levels of isolation for people who are positive or sick, so that we can really reduce transmission and avoid the surges that we have seen over the past many weeks.
Final question on Ibarra, how matters?
Hi, Dr. Ghaly. In terms of COVID and flu, can you give us more specific examples of what the state and the healthcare system are doing to prepare for the fall and winter months? I mean, what exactly is being done that will be different or amplified to what the state has been doing in previous months?
Yeah, no, thank you for the question. You know, first and foremost, I think it starts right now with flu vaccine and really getting the message out, making sure that we set up infrastructure, not just in the traditional places where flu vaccine is often available, often anchored to sometimes you can get it at work, sometimes you'll be able to get it in, or often you'll be able to get it connected to your regular provider, your nurse practitioner, your physician's assistants, your doctor's office, all of these places, really working with our healthcare partners to increase the sites and availability of where the vaccine could be available, making sure that we have no risk of our supply, and really trying to increase penetration of the flu vaccine so that we might actually reduce the number of people who are at risk because they're protected. Secondly, it is what I would say is doubling down on the message, those protective measures about the wear your mask, physically distance, wash your hands, avoid unnecessary mixing, all of those same things that help at COVID. We want to really shift and make sure that it's not just a COVID response, that people understand that it's a flu response. And then things like protecting our most vulnerable. Unlike flu, COVID has not had, as of yet, as significant an impact on young people. Although we are, because we're seeing more young people get tested, we're identifying some more cases, flu is notorious for having a grave impact on our youngest Californians, infants, toddlers. So making sure that we deliver the message strongly about the need to protect around flu, and not just thinking about COVID. And then there is the planning around our surge capacity and making sure that hospitals are not just thinking about COVID alone, but are also planning around the potential for increased cases needing hospitalization with flu. Just as a quick data point, in the 2017-2018 flu season, we estimated, based on extrapolating the Center for Disease Control data, that roughly 5.6 million Californians may have been infected by flu, that this led to over 100,000 hospitalizations and nearly or over 7,500 deaths in California. So flu is not to be taken lightly. And together, flu and COVID create a doubly risky situation. So pushing forward all of our messages and ensuring that hospital preparedness is really as strong as it can be are things we are working hard to secure now. So again, thank you for the questions and the opportunity to share a little bit about where we are as a state, to give you a view on how this has impacted children, and to really make a strong plug for focusing on your own health, that it's as much about COVID as it is about flu as we move into the fall months, and that we all have a responsibility that we can all do this together to reduce not just the impact on COVID, but flu together and get through the fall and winter if we prepare now. So with that, good afternoon, and we will see you soon.